All right. So today we're going to read and comment on and get deeper into the Law of One, session five. This was conducted January 23, 1981. I assume you have the link, but I'll send it here anyway. This is the re-listened version, and actually we only have three questions and answers here. Or, after Ra's initial greeting, there's really only 5.1 and 2 and 3, and that's the whole session. And we're focused here on healing and a little bit about the way of establishing the contact that Ra was recommending, the methods recommended for the LNL group of Jim and Carla and Don. And, so Ra greets them. Maybe some words were lost here at 5.0. Ra said, "Greet you, I'm Ra, or I greet you in the love and the light of the infinite creator." And that's the way they normally open. Now 5.1 is the introduction in this session to the discussion of healing. Don says, "The last time we communicated, we were speaking of learning of healing. It's my impression that from what you gave to us in the earlier session, that it's necessary to first purify the self by certain disciplines and exercises. Then, in order to heal a patient, it is necessary, by example, and possibly certain exercises, to create a mental configuration in the patient that allows him to heal himself. Am I correct?" You'll see that, as we know this more and better, Don's approach was correct, but a little not quite subtle here, and he was learning what Ra was, what Ra hadn't presented fully, trying to get a handle on it. How actually does healing occur? And Ra answers, and again, this is all preliminary, and we're just going deeper and deeper and taking successive passes into the body of the teaching. Ra says, "Although your learn understanding distortion is essentially correct, your choice of vibratory sound complex is not entirely as accurate as this language allows." Meaning, although your learning and your understanding about this is basically correct, that the healer is helping the patient or the other heal him or herself, your choice of words is not quite as accurate as it could be. Ra goes on, "It is not by example that the healer does the working. The working exists in and of itself. The healer is only the catalyst, much as this instrument, Carla, has the catalysis necessary to provide the channel for our words, yet by example or exercise of any kind can take no thought for this working. The healing working is congruent in that it is a form of channeling some form of intelligent infinity." So healers don't do healing by example. And so in therapy, this is one principle that some people assume is working, is that the therapist models and the patient observes and then mimics or copies the modeling. The therapist is modeling empathy or modeling receptivity or sincere dialogue or something. That is not quite the way it works, because the healer doesn't heal. The person seeking healing heals himself, herself. Healing is done by the self, for the self, by the self-healing properties of the self. Ra actually said that line at some point. And so, like Carla doing channeling, it's simply that she herself has the conditions of her being available, or the conditions of her being are such that they will allow channeling to occur. the healer has developed him or herself in such a way, in mind and body and spirit, in terms of their energy fields, in terms of their understanding, in terms of a self-purification, although Ra doesn't really use that word purification, because it sort of implies that they're dirty and becoming clean, and that's not what's happening. It's releasing distortions or energy blockages. It's dissolving energy blockages associated with the chakras, particularly, and chakra relations, which is the same as moving out of distortions in mind. Distortions in mind are basically reflexive emotional patterns, like anger, irritation, frustration, short-temperedness, anything associated with aversion, and greed, sorrow, self-pity, discouragement, long-term disappointment, a certain kind of hunger, a certain kind of feeling of emptiness, a certain kind of feeling of deficiency, and then fear and avoidance and distracted mind and frustration with being unable to focus. All there's basically, it fits into the Buddhist triad of grasping, aversion, and ignorance. These are called the three poisons in Buddhism. And as we keep reading, I will keep bringing up the connections between Buddhist theory and Ra's teaching. And the three poisons in Buddhism, desire, aversion, and ignorance, is basically plus, minus, and zero. And you'll see this whole thing about everything that exists is actually a visible polarity that is complemented by an invisible opposite pole. And so every form of desire, every time we want, it's associated with something that we don't want. And every time there's something we hate, aversion, get it away, it's associated with something we do want and want to hold on to. So grasping and aversion are two sides of the same coin, or I want to take, or I want to get rid of, or I love it and I hate it. Love it in the sense of I want to get it and hold it. Hate it is aversion. These are both based on ignorance, and these are basically the templates, or the roots of distortion in mind. In psychological terms, we can talk about self-conflict and limiting beliefs, core beliefs. If you think silence is indifference, silence is neglect, then we can't be silent with somebody. If we think that the world is a hard place and I've got to be tough, then we end up walking around with a hard shell. If we think, that there's no God, or there's no soul, or there's no life purpose, there's no higher design, then we may think that life is unfair, and I'm a helpless victim, and things don't make sense, and there's no God, and everything is just random, and no, there's no order, there's nothing here, there's just human process. So the limiting belief, or the particular beliefs that we are very unconscious of normally, are the undergirding of our instinctive emotional process and ways of being in the world. So that's psychology. So in this discussion, I draw from psychology, from Ra's teaching, from Buddhism, and then from my experience doing counseling 20 years plus, and understanding energetics. The association between chakras, energy conditions, and mind. So, the healer doesn't effect healing by their example. they don't affect healing by some kind of exercise. The healer is the one who has developed him or herself in mind and energy system such that they can channel intelligent energy from intelligent infinity. They become a crystal. So Ra said of Yeshua, Jesus, the crystallized healer has no will. The crystallized healer is a person who has cleared the major blockages of second, third chakras associated with the personal identity and the personality in society, in group, which is the emotional and the intellectual. And they also, that healer has also very highly developed love and wisdom and balanced, coordinated fourth and fifth chakras, and highly developed and coordinated with sixth chakra, which is the opening to the unified self or the law of one or the realization that all is one and one is all, emptiness of selfhood, and the greater identity. And that allows the downflow of energy through the crown chakra, seventh chakra at the top of the head, through the sixth chakra, third eye, forehead, middle of the brain, into the body, into the torso, out of the hands, through the radiant field through the body. And that's what the healing really is. And that's not done by personal willing, but by the crystallization of one's energy fields. And that's the result of working on our psychology, knowing our psychology, and meeting it with acceptance, unconditional acceptance, and understanding. And that is the working. That's the self-working that prepares the healer to be the channel for intelligent energy or for universal energy or prana or chi or whatever you want to call it, like Reiki, the different systems of channeling energy. The preparation of the healer is what allows them to be part of a healing. But what's essential is that the person receives and reconfigures their energy field and their thinking, their mind and body, their energy and their consciousness in accord with a less distorted way. Meaning, you can take the horse to water, but you can't make him drink. The person heals himself. No healer does healing. Healing exists as it is and is achieved by the strong desire and the capacity of the person to do it for themselves with the help of the healer. So, 5.2. 5.2 is the heart of session 5. And Ra basically goes to the next level of presentation of the teachings associated with healing. And so Don says, "We have decided to accept, if offered, the honor duty of learning teaching," so he's already using Laura's language, "the honor duty of learning teaching the healing process. I would ask as to the first step which we should accomplish in becoming effective healers." And so, first of all, when I read the raw material once and twice in the late 80s and the mid 90s, I never realized that that raw material was about teaching healing. It was about healing, self-healing, and the way of this that transformation. I didn't know that. I knew it was about wanderers and UFO and ET and world process and history and cosmology, but I didn't find this stuff because I just read over it. And not until the 19, until I guess the 10 years ago or so, did I realize that the heart of the raw material is the teachings on healing, healing and initiation. And I put together the PDF, which you should have or you can have, which is the basis of many YouTube lectures or commentaries on my channel from that PDF on healing and balance. Principles of healing, principles of the One Infinite Creator, healing and balance. And I really felt a higher calling in mind, in spirit, to produce that PDF, which was about 55 pages, and it was pretty much unused for 5 years or more. And it's a compilation of all of Ra's teaching on healing, which includes this session quote, the session, portion, and others. This is what Ra really was here to give as the basis of the Law of One. We can talk about all is one, and you are everything and every thought and every situation. True. But how do you come to live it? So Carla wrote a book, Living the Law of One. How? Well, it's only done by self-healing and initiation. And most people who read the raw material don't get it or don't understand that this is what it's all about. It's not the cosmology of creation, how the universe was born, or the mind of the infinite creator, or UFO ET and positive negative and Orion Confederation and history and dimensional shift and harvest and wanderers. That's actually not the heart of what they're teaching. It's essential, but it's not core. Because the core, like the teachings of Buddha or Gautama Buddha, are the way of self-transformation. It doesn't, interesting ideas don't mean much if we're very stuck emotionally and we don't know how to make good relationship and we're conflicted with ourselves and fight ourselves and walk around in some unrecognized distress and never really feel peace or never really enjoy anything. Most people are this way. So what's the nature, what's the value of understanding cosmology or higher dimensional life or multidimensional life and wanderers and all of this if we never come to ease, if we never make release? It's like a rich man in rags. What's the point if you don't use your money to bring yourself well or to use it for benefit? So this is getting into the heart of what Ra wants us to know, which is how we may transform ourselves from ignorance and suffering to wisdom and well-being in service to all. And so Don is saying, okay, we're willing, we decided that we want to accept, and this was a decision that the group made, of course, before this session, and they were thinking about it in the last few sessions, that they would like to learn how to become effective healers. Now, Ra gave the teachings on self-healing, and in fact, very, very little of those teachings include techniques or methods of working on others. Very little, and very non-specific. And that's great, because people don't need more technique that they can misunderstand and misuse. And so, if the person hasn't done that purification or freeing of confusion and pain and conflict, then they really should not be working on others in a big way. Certainly not by technique and crystals and energy and things. And almost all the so-called healers you see today in the communities, in the New Age movement, and here and there around the world, almost all of them are at an intermediate level of their own healing. Some of the most wounded people around are healers. Some of the most wounded people around are psychologists. And so that's why they got into it. The question is, how far can they go? And it's not really important to be a healer of others, because when you've done the real work of healing and initiation of the self, naturally one is a force of healing universally, or naturally one is a radiant healing source of love and wisdom, fourth chakra, fifth chakra. One radiates love light, love wisdom naturally, as the healing and initiation is achieved by the self. And that's really enough. If one wants to do the physical work or energy work with others, fine. But it's not necessary. So, Don saying, I'd ask what's the first step we should accomplish in becoming effective healers? And Ra says, we shall begin with the first of the three teachings, learnings. So Ra will begin with the first of the three teachings about healing. We begin with the mental learning teachings necessary for contact with intelligent infinity. The prerequisite of mental work is the ability to retain silence of self at a steady state when required by the self. The mind must be opened like a door. The key is silence. Now, these are the teachings necessary for contact with intelligent infinity. Intelligent infinity is accessed by the linkage between sixth and seventh chakra, forehead, crown, sixth dimensional, seventh dimensional. Not better than the lower chakras, but less distorted in their nature, the higher centers, and necessary for receiving universal energy, you see. The healer really is a vessel or a channel, and the healer is like a purified circuit board that can receive and transmit. Or, I don't know all the right electrical terms, but there's a certain transformer ability to the healer's energy field. So when Jesus or Yeshua met the lepers and people who were all in trouble and said, "Heal me, Master," he was able, by his achieved healing and balance initiation himself, to allow his own energy fields to receive and transmit, to download and transform and send out and radiate and transfer to the person needing healing. But the fact that the person could receive and create that self-transformation of healing is due to the person, not to the sender of energy. So the healer needs to really do energy healing. The person needs to have an activated and developed energy field. The energy field means the seven bodies, seven energy fields associated with the seven chakras, not just one energy field, but the seven interpenetrating energy fields that are associated with seven chakras. Now, that would allow contact with intelligent infinity, which is a download from the infinite, which is accessed by seventh chakra through sixth chakra, which becomes intelligent energy, which then is channeled out in association with fourth or fifth or sixth chakras itself. So there's an, if you think of the seven chakras, like a column, there's an incoming energy to the crown, to the head. It's not as simple as this, but it's one way to look at it. The radiant aura of the head vibrates in harmony in some way with the reality of unity and infinity, the source, with absolute reality. By that resonance, there's the capacity to download from seven to six chakras. From that, which is called intelligent energy, there's the transformation transformer, like an energy trans electricity transformer. There is the capacity to transform that intelligent energy, sixth chakra, the result of contact with intelligent infinity, to transform and emit or send or offer that transformed intelligent energy through green, blue, and indigo itself. Fourth, fifth, and sixth chakras. Green, blue, indigo. Meaning that what comes through for the other may be of the quality of comfort, love, unconditional acceptance, being with, caring. It may be of the nature of wisdom. It may be the nature of wisdom, guidance, advice, information, truth, self-reflective knowing. It may be the nature of an energy transmission, pure and simple, which is indigo six transmission. And so to do that requires for real contact with intelligent infinity. That begins with being able to have a quiet mind. The prerequisite of all mental work is the ability to retain silence of self at a steady state when required by the self. Self, no self. It's requiring, it's achieving or dwelling comfortably with a silent mind. That's called samadhi in Buddhism. That's the result of concentration, one-pointedness, quiet mind. I remember once in the monastery, I had a chance to leave for something and do something, go somewhere, and I was thinking about vacation, you know. And I thought, what's the point of going on vacation anywhere if my mind is upset? How can I enjoy anything if I bring this upset mind with me? And so, you know, people spend a lot of money and go to the five-star resorts so as to comfort themselves while their busy, conflicted mind remains the same. What kind of vacation is that? You can't take a vacation from your mind, but you can transform and purify the mind by learning how to move towards silence. So, Taoist saying is, power gathers where there is stillness. Stillness equals silence of mind. Silence of mind is the door. It's just the beginning. The mind must be opened like a door. The key is silence. If one can't dwell comfortably in silent mind somewhat, one really has a hard time knowing the mind. You know, we can say self, self all the time, but really we're talking about our being knowing its mind. We as a being knowing mind. Being at ease in mind. Transforming mind so it is a place of wellness, a warm home, a lovely place, a beautiful mind, right? Like the movie. There cannot be a beautiful mind when there's no silence in the mind. So, silence of self at a steady state means a quiet mind dwelling. And that's exactly what Vipassana mindfulness type meditation will lead to, but it's not the end of the line, it's actually the foundation for deeper work, which is insight, which is realizing the nature of mind and the nature of self and what freedom from this is. So silence of mind is the prerequisite for anything. And that's why when we do that meditation, Vipassana or mindfulness, and develop one-pointedness and concentration, it's easier to identify what's happening in mind, which is commonly called knowing yourself. And so it's easier to know, okay, using the terms I'm really angry, or wow, I have a lot of anger, or wow, this deep pain really is under my anger. Wow, I walk around as a tough guy, but actually I'm a real softy. Or wow, it's very hard for me to not talk or to not jump into the situation. Or yeah, I don't really want to feel my sadness because I really don't like it. Or yeah. This mind has all these patterns that I'm not directing. It goes by itself, the monkey mind. So all those contents and processes of mind are more easily recognized when the mind is quiet. and the mind becomes quiet in practice by technique, by concentration. That's the concentration on the breath, or the mantra, or the candle, or whatever it may be. And silence of mind is a true vacation, is a true holiday. Then, Ra says, within the door of mind, finding the deeper mind, within the door lies a hierarchical construction. You may liken unto geography, and in some ways, geometry. For the hierarchy is quite irregular, bearing inner relationships. Now, this is a really deep comment about the nature of mind as being hierarchical, just like the three chakras, first, second, and third, can be seen as a linear hierarchy, in the vertical, right? The first is below the second, and the third chakra is above the second, and one is down and one is up. That visual or temporal, spatial hierarchy, with solar plexus is above the middle belly and the sacrum, and that's above the base of the spine, and this ordering is a symbolic representation of the depths of mind, of the different layers of mind that begin with the surface personal and go to the deeper personal, and then go to the collective and the racial and the planetary. And this is, at a deeper level, is where we get into the discussion of the archetypes, the tarot cards presented by Ra to the initiates in Egypt, the first 22 cards, major arcana only, representing a training system for understanding the hierarchical mind and the processes and relationships between aspects of mind in the deep personal, in the deep collective mind, actually. Everybody has those 22 aspects, or 22 aspects of those cards can be identified in the geography of mind, that is, 3D mind, physical body, 3D mind, in the solar system. That's associated with all 3D mind, veiled mind in the solar system. So that's a deeper level of mind. But one of the takeaways is, if you don't know something, ask yourself. And if you want to know an answer, ask yourself, because all the answers are in the deeper mind. And that's called the that's the potentiator of mind. So the conscious mind in the tarot system that Ra gives, the conscious mind is called the matrix of mind. And it's the first card, it's the magician. And the second card is called the potentiator of mind. The potentiator of mind is the unconscious, and that's the high priestess. And the interplay between those two is what produces experience and ultimately the significator, or the development of true mind. The revealing of true mind comes by the deep interplay between the conscious and the unconscious, or the matrix and the potentiator. And that relates then, so the 22 cards show us, in some ways, the geometry of the deeper hierarchical mind. The hierarchy is quite regular and bears inner relationships, and again, there's a relationship between the chakras, right? So there's a particular relationship between 1, 3, 5, 7, and the hard line, and another relationship is called 2, 4, 6, the soft line. There's a relationship between 7 and 1, 2 and 6, 5 and 3, and on and on and on. 2 and 5 has a relationship. So 1 and 4 has a relationship. They all have, many, many. They're all related. But there are key relations between particular chakras also. And so that's the regular hierarchy and the inner relationships of mind. Then, the third paragraph. To begin to master the concept of mental discipline, it is necessary to examine the self. Now, this is the beginning of the four. What they call the four steps of learning mental discipline. The Path to the Disciplined Personality. Discipline not in the sense of being a hard-ass taskmaster, but the ordering of mind, so that mind is not a crazy man, but mind is a well-trained helper. For most people, mind is way out of control, and monkey mind is not just monkey, but he's an insane monkey, and he's psychotic, and that's normal. And if you watch too much television, you will damage your brain. Period. And if you hang out with stupid people, you will become stupid. So be careful who you're with. And be careful what you pay attention to. Because distortions are infectious. Ross said, we cannot plumb the depths of the distortions that infect your peoples. I mean, again, it's not about becoming square and uptight and elitist or anything, but we don't want to harm ourselves. And there are a lot of people whose minds are very messed up at this time in history. And so the opposite of that is the view of what's called mental discipline, the disciplined personality. And it's not. You know, it's not uptight, but it's well ordered in truth. So, to move towards the disciplined personality or to understand what mental discipline is all about, it's necessary to examine the self, know yourself. The polarity of your dimension, and this is the first of the four exercises, the polarity of your dimension, and this stuff is not that applicable in a sense, because it becomes second nature when you know the principles, but it takes a long time to really get this. Much easier to talk about chakra relations. So, this first step, the first mental discipline, examining the self, involves these aspects. The polarity of your dimension must be internalized. Where you find patience within your mind, you must consciously find the corresponding impatience, and vice versa. Each thought that a being has in its turn an antithesis. The disciplines of the mind involve, first of all, identifying both those things of which you approve and those things of which you disapprove within yourself or mind, and then balancing each and every positive and negative with its equal. The mind contains all things, therefore you must discover this completeness within yourself. So the first step is discover the completeness of your own mind. The second step is actually accepting it. The third step is accepting the completeness of others' mind, and the fourth step is accepting it. So discovery and acceptance, which is, you know, understanding or recognizing and accepting, that leads to understanding. This is the discipline of understanding. In fact, that's a phrase where I use the discipline of understanding. So know yourself, accept yourself, know the other, and accept the other. To know the self or to know the other, examine the self, it's what Ra's calling the internalization of the polarity of our dimension. The polarity of our dimension is when I, so I gave the example. I'm in a relationship, this person has certain patterns that are selfish. Insensitive, disconnected, basically unloving, but unreasonable, even unfair and unrecognized. I feel anger, I feel frustration, I feel impatience, I feel, you know, irritation. Those emotional reactions are made totally by me in relation to that person's behavior. They're responsible for their behavior, and I'm responsible for my reactions. But I know I need not be an angry man. I don't want to be an angry man. I don't want to be stuck in anger. This is an instance of internalizing the polarity of our dimension. Where I found anger, I could find acceptance. Where I found impatience, I could find patience. Where I found dysfunctional or distorted reactions, I recognize that I could be a different way. I don't have to be an angry person, no matter what she is. I don't have to be. I don't want to be. It's unnecessary. So I found within myself, or within the mind, the corresponding qualities of mind that balanced those polarized expressions of anger, frustration, irritation that I was stuck in. So, excuse me, from silence of mind, or quiet in mind, I could observe those patterns. Oh, look, I always get angry with her. And then I could acknowledge, oh, I don't have to be this way. I don't want to be this way. I know I can be another way. Then I could find those qualities. Oh, I can be patient. I can be quiet. I can let it be. I can let it go. Let go my need for her to be otherwise. Let go my need or desire for the relationship to be otherwise, meaning to be good, to be mutual, to be close, because it isn't with a person who has these patterns of insensitivity. Okay, I could find within myself the peace of not needing a good relationship with this person, and the peace associated with being okay with myself, even though this person is really not capable of intimacy. Okay, I can let go of my need. So this is, in a sense, finding the antithesis to the appearance of the patterns of thinking and feeling. So what appears is the external, or the phenomena that appears in the relationship, in the situation, is the polarity that's obvious, the apparent polarity. I'm angry. The internalizing of that polarity leads to discovery of the antithesis. The antithesis is the complement. And so, where I have hate, I could have love. The moment contains love. Where I am upset, I could be relaxed. How do I know? Because I know, because they exist together. And so, where I have inconsolable grief, I know I also could have acceptance of loss, or the ability to go on without, to do without. So anyway, it gets very subtle, and Ra's way of explaining it is it needs a lot of breaking down to put into the context of our normal way of thinking and experiencing our mind and our life in situations. So, this polarity of the dimension being internalized is balancing itself, and it's finding, identifying those, or say, identifying those, both those things of which you approve and those things of which you disapprove within yourself, within the mind, then balancing each and every positive and negative with its equal. And so, discovering the completeness within oneself, as the mind contains all things, you hear a report of a rapist, some horrible, cruel people on earth, and feel enraged. It's natural. Meanwhile, we could be that way too. Now, I'm not saying, I'm not counseling leniency, and I'm not saying people shouldn't be punished. But many people walk around very stuck in hatred against the evil. I have been. It's easy. But that's also stuck, meaning walking around hating the evil ones. And there are many. But I'm not afraid to see them as they are. But I also don't want to walk around hating or being overly concerned. Because what can I do? And it is, I can send love light. I can bless, but I don't want to walk around hating or broken down. So, how to w move through it? And so that's a balancing process, and that's understanding myself or the mind, my mind, the mind, and understanding the polarized antithesis or opposite of the conditions of mind that we find ourselves stuck in. And so balancing each and every positive and negative charge with its equal, that's the hardest, this is the hardest phase of the healing work, the portion of mental discipline of self-examination and finding the wholeness in mind rather than being stuck by picking and choosing. And Ra will later talk about how picking and choosing is a problem. And so that's the second mental discipline, which is acceptance. So they go on. The second mental discipline is acceptance of the completeness within your consciousness. Also said, acceptance of the completeness of mind. It is not for a being of polarity in the physical consciousness to pick and choose among attributes, thus building the roles that cause blockages and confusions in the already distorted mind complex. Each acceptance smooths part of the many distortions that the faculty you call judgment engenders. So the second mental discipline is to accept the discovered completeness of the self-mind. And Ra say, for us in third density, which is a being of polarity, beingness in polarity or experiencing polarity, which means any kind of oppositional, any kind of oppositionalism. Oppositionalism meaning there's me and you, there's day and night, there's good and bad, there's pain and ease, there's healthy and unhealthy, there's blocked and unblocked, there's what I like and what I don't like, there's what I think is high and what I think is low. That's polarity. So we experience polarity, you know, nearly 24/7, except until we move out of it. for a being of polarity or in polarity in physical consciousness, if we pick and choose among qualities, we will build roles or we will create more blockages. We'll create more distortions and confusion in an already distorted mind. So, I love kindness and I hate anger. I hate my anger. Okay, well, how do I expect to get out of it if I hate it? Cannot be done. I hate what's bad. Well, hating is bad too, right? Well, I guess then, if I hate it, I hold it. So if you hate it, you hold it. If you avoid it, you hold it. The only way to stop holding it and put it down, is to be with it, which is acceptance. And so each acceptance smooths part of the many distortions that faculty called judgment engenders or creates. Judgment. That's bad. That's good. I like when I'm this way. I hate when I'm that way. That is all self-knotting. Knott. Knotting. Knotting up the mind. And that creates energy blockages, which equal mind distortions. That is. All of that is ultimately based in false beliefs, false limiting core beliefs, false limiting core beliefs. Like, I need to be a tough guy to walk through my life, or, you know, this is good and that is bad, and that's just the way it is for everybody, or, you know, I need my partner to be the same as me. Or everybody is the same as me, right? And there are million, many, many deeper beliefs that are distorted, that are associated with judgment, and right and wrong, good and bad, and what I can accept and what I hate. And that creates more distortion. And social roles or social costuming. That leads to more pain and confusion later. Like the person, you know, the man who loses his job and then he goes to drinking and hates himself and kills himself. Why? Because he had some positive sense of self associated with his role as, you know, in his company at the job. And he judges himself as being so inferior and unworthy of living if he doesn't have that job. So all kinds of self-judgment, a judgment of other, creates more distortion. And it's the opposite of acceptance. So, know yourself, accept yourself, examine and discover the completeness of mind, then accept it. The third discipline of mind is a repetition of the first, but with the gaze outward towards the fellow entities that it meets, that one meets, other people. In each entity there exists completeness also. You know, you see, what Ra's really saying is, in mind, the mind contains all things. That's the point. The mind contains all things is your mind and the mind of others too. So that's what, in each entity there exists completeness, is the meaning. The meaning of that is, in the self-mind and in the other mind or other self-mind, there is completeness. Mind contains all things. Thus, Ra goes on, the ability to understand each balance is necessary, which is basically doing the first kind of practice for others. When you view patience, you're responsible for mirroring in your mental understanding patience in patience. When you view impatience, it's necessary, or this is the practice, it's necessary for your mental configuration of understanding to move your mind towards understanding impatience, patience. So when you view one thing, you can recognize its polarized antithesis or opposite in the mind and in others, in ourselves and in others. So I can find my anger, and I hate my anger, I judge my anger, but I also can find peace and balance them together and know that all conditions are possible in this mind, and therefore I don't have to be stuck in any one of them. If I want to be, I will be, and I'm stuck because I can't let it go because I think I need it, based in some limiting core beliefs. But in knowing the self and knowing the other, which is the same actually, because mind is mind. So-called inside, so-called outside, mind is mind. Know yourself, know the world. The key is to discover and accept the wholeness of mind, and that's where forgiveness can come from, right? So you can see the person acting cruelly or badly. You can also see the pain in their mind, and you can also see why they're acting this way and their woundedness. So this is what a healer needs to see, and a therapist, and a friend, to see the deeper levels below the surface. So Ra says, most configurations of mind have many facets, for sure, and that they are using this as a simple example, the idea of viewing impatience and mirroring impatience, patience. It took me many years to figure out what they're saying here, so don't worry about it. Most configurations of mind have many facets, and understanding of either self-polarities or what you would call other self-polarities can and must be understood as subtle work. Subtle work. How many channels talk about subtle work? How many channels can even follow what we're talking about here? So yes, indeed, there are levels of teachers. And some teachers are done, and some teachers are junior students. Let it be known. The final of the four stages, the next step is the acceptance of other self-polarities, which mirrors the second step. So know yourself, accept yourself, know the other, and accept the other. This is making peace with mind. This is our true being making peace with mind. Its mind and the other mind. The quality of mind. So all manifestation, generally, let's just say, non-enlightened manifestation of mind represents a polarized appearance. The antithesis or opposite, the other pole, is unrecognized, but it's there too. It's potential. There's actual and potential. So everything that is actual, the appearance, is supported by an unrecognized, not yet apparent or hidden or subtle counterpart, counterpoint, polarity. And so the person who, you know, us in our anger, is based on us or the mind in its peace. And when we're impatient, as this example they gave, there is the capacity for patience there too. And in fact, it's embedded in the patient, in the impatience. That's the interesting thing. Embedded, hidden, buried within the substance or the nature of that experience of mind is its polarized opposite. Love comes only with love light. Light comes only with light love. There is no one without the counterpoint appearing or being within it. And so there's the appearance and there's the cause. The cause is always hidden within the appearance, or the counterpart, or the polarized counterpole, counterpart, counterpoint. The opposite, the apparently opposite, is embedded in the polarized expression. This is very, very subtle, and it goes far beyond an understanding of mind and healing into the nature of experience and the nature of phenomena. So, meaning all apparent phenomena are simply the visible expression of hidden noumena, meaning sacred and boundless. And so the apparent and limited is itself a manifestation of the hidden and unlimited. And that's the same way that ultimately all love is love light, or all light is light love. All energy is essentially free will. Anyway, it goes into cosmology and the nature of existence. So, know yourself and know the completeness of mind for oneself, and then accept it. Discover the completeness of the mind of others, see that, accept it. And those are the first four steps. So Ross says these are the first four steps of learning mental discipline. The fifth step involves observing. So if you can get through those four, you're pretty good. But it's doable more and more. The fifth step involves observing the geographical and geometrical relationships and ratios of the mind, the other mind, the mass mind, and the infinite mind. That's where the study of the archetypes comes in. And we can get to that later if we get into the later sessions. So, fine, and that is just working on mind. Okay? Now, the second area of learned teaching is the study understanding of the body complexes. It's necessary to know your body well. This is a matter of using the mind to examine how the feelings, the biases, and what you would call the emotions affect various portions of the body complex. It shall be necessary to both understand the body polarities and to accept them, repeating in a chemical, physical manifestation the work you have done upon the mind, bethinking the consciousness. The body is a creature of the mind's creation. It's an important phrase. The body is a creature of the mind's creation. It has its biases. The biological bias must be first completely understood, and then the opposite bias allowed to find full expression in understanding. Again, the process of acceptance of the body as a balanced as well as polarized individual may then be accomplished. It is then the task to extend this understanding to the bodies, meaning our thinking about the bodies, of other selves whom you meet. The simplest example of this is the understanding that each biological male is female, each biological female is male. And again, this is the law of one. This is bringing, this is exercising our preliminary understanding of the law of one as it applies to mind, other mind, and body, and other's body, which is to see wholeness in the apparently limited and apparently polarized. So, the simplest example of this is the understanding that each biological male is female, each biological female is male. This is a simple example. However, in almost every case wherein you are attempting the understanding of the body of self or other self, you will again find that the most subtle discernment is necessary in order to fully grasp the polarity complexes involved. They close it at this time. We'd suggest closing the description until the next time of work, so that we may devote time to the third area, commensurate with its importance. The third area is the disciplines of spirit, the spirit complex, and the particularly sixth and seventh chakra work. And that is the heart of this session. The last question, and I'll go back to the body thing, body work again. The last question, 5.3, is just asking about is Carla comfortable? Anything else we can do to help her more comfortable? And Ross said the candle could be rotated clockwise approximately 10 degrees. This is a narrow band transmission. This is a serious contact. The candle could be rotated clockwise approximately 10 degrees each session to improve the flow of spiraled energy through the being's receiving mechanisms. This was some kind of alignment of the candle that was associated with a precision of intentionality, precision of intention, precision of commitment to total self-offering by Carla for the working. And so they said, we asked that the objects described, meaning the candle and the chalice and the Bible and incense censer, we ask that the objects described and used be centered with geometric care and checked from time to time. Also, that they not be exposed to that space-time in which work is not of importance, meaning don't take them out and play with them, and don't use them in other times other than doing the channeling sessions. And that is not that those items have some kind of magical power, but that the quality of the group, of the mind of each of the people, Carla, Jim, Don, doing the working, is associated with the degree of geometric care that they were showing to perfectly align and measure. They used ruler and measured things. The alignment and the proportions and ratio, the relations, geometries between the items that were used there as the props, actually, to help her move to the right state of mind and the group. This was done for them to improve the transmission as a demonstration of their commitment. And that's the case with ritual too. Some part of ritual in general has its power by the exercise of diligence and there's a word I'm looking for. It's not it's related to impeccable, but it's very serious and diligent in responsibility for excellence. And those qualities of mind are associated with this contact with a narrow band transmission. And they're associated with deep work on self, and deep capacity to help other. So to just go back a bit, the body is a creature of the mind's creation. Basically, it's understanding the biological bias of the body. The body wants to eat and sleep and have sex, and it likes warm, and it likes soft, comfortable, or whatever. That's the biological basis, and we can see it in our life in arising, all the time. Then the opposite bias, also allowed to find full expression and understanding or be fully understood. The opposite bias is the mind wishing to control the body against its biological bias. It's the non-biological bias of the body and its withdrawal from those activities, which the body also has a tendency to. The body, enjoys some challenge or gets some benefit from not eating, this kinds of thing, or the disciplining of body by mind. The process here is the process of acceptance of body as a balanced as well as polarized individual. the body as an individual. And then we extend that understanding to others and see the completeness of biological and non-biological tendencies of the body. And this is very, to get into the details is very detail, very subtle. You see, the work on body follows the work on mind. And so it's more advanced than the work on mind. And it's associated very much with allowing the kinks and the crinkles, the blockages in the electrical system to heal themselves by a kind of surrender. So it's actually adept practices that are associated with the deeper working on body, because it's working on the etheric body, it's on the energy body. Okay, so I think I went on very long there, but you see, this is really heavy, heavy duty. So Don is saying, help us become effective healers, and Ra is giving a very profound introduction to the healing and balancing of mind, and then body, and then spirit. So it'll all get clearer as you listen to it again. It's basically know yourself, accept yourself, know the others, the mind of others, and accept that. Know the body in what it likes, what it doesn't like, and its natural way, and the way of going against that natural way, and the wholeness of body tendencies or body qualities, the integration of what appears and what's hidden. And so let's end for now. Yeah, you see, again, the first time I read this stuff, I didn't have any idea what they were talking about. And after going through it a lot many times and going through the PDF, Healing and Balance, I can get some sense of what they mean. And the key is to try to understand the essence and then practicalize it, make it operational, practical in how we think about ourselves. And so finding examples is really important, and that shows whether we understand it or not, whether I understand it or not. And it gets clearer as we approach it from different angles. There are many different angles that Ra presents in discussing the healing of mind and body and spirit. But you can see that balancing equals healing. And balancing is to find the balance of what appears single. And so we feel, I'm angry. But there's something hidden there that we don't see. And there is that the mind that says, or the mind that says, I'm angry, or the consciousness that's aware of anger, is itself not angry. If I say I'm so upset, that comes from a position of consciousness that is not upset and can identify itself as upset. So what's identified is the polarized opposite of the qualities of mind that do the identification. Yeah. Well, I think that that capacity to observe comes from stillness. The one that says it's moving is not moving. The one that says I'm angry is not angry. There's the distinction between the identifier and what's identified. The identification, or the observer and the observed. And this is not really a distinction, but it's useful to see it this way. Meaning, I feel so angry. Well, that observation is done from a position that is separate from what's being observed. And that's a very strange thing. Right. Yes. And It's basically separating so as to later unify. From a it's very subtle. From the initial condition of an unrecognized identification, I am anger. I am angry. I am angry equals, or I am angry means I equals angry. But actually, there is an observer in mind that can observe, that is observing the anger. So it's a misidentification. The equation or identity that we assume is I am anger. I am angry equals I is anger. The me is angry. But actually, we can split that, and that's the first separation of an unrecognized identification, which is no. Who, what is observing anger? The fact that we're actually identifying it and saying there's anger, observing anger, indicates that there's an observer who is not of that nature. And that's not the end of the game, but that's separate, that's basically looking into an unrecognized identification. Whenever I meet my mom, I feel so terrible, I feel like a child. Well, the fact that you can identify that indicates that there's a portion of mind, or there's an observing place in mind that is not of that. And that's an initial separation, and that's what you call getting distance. And that's done in meditation when we're following the breath, and then thoughts arise. It means we recognize that thoughts are coming up into a quiet place of mind. I was sitting in meditation, and bang, all these memories came back, and I felt so much sadness. This is coming from stillness. That's the same thing you do when you're observing the mind outside meditation. It's the same kind of thing. And it's splitting that unrecognized identification with the emotion. Then we realize, oh, okay, anger and these emotions come and go. Who is it that experiences that? Well, clearly, it's not those emotions. It's an observer. Now, one can also get stuck then at that level and think, okay, I am the still silent point of observation. I'm a big I, EYE. I am the I in mind. Self is the sun that observes all the contents of mind occurring in the sky of mind. That's actually not true also, because that is taking observation, or the quality of observation as a self. And so that has to be broken too. And then ultimately one is free of any of that split or those identifications. And so there's a traditional Vedic saying, and I use this in my book, when the knower, the known, and the means to knowledge are one, then there is Brahman. Brahman meaning absolute creator, full enlightenment. When the knower, the known, and the means to knowledge are one, then there is Godhead, or absolute consciousness, absolute awareness. And that unity is, but that unity actually comes after that second stage of recognizing that the observer is not the emotion. Okay? So first you have to go from the apparent to the basis of the apparent. And then you have to go from the apparent and the basis of the apparent both being empty. This is, a couple of steps ahead. And that's called freedom from attachment to emptiness. So form is empty, meaning the stuff that we observe has an invisible basis, or is not substantial. It's process. And then that emptiness, if it's identified as a thing, is also another form to be dissolved, or to be seen as empty. So emptiness is empty. Or our beliefs about what is, are also empty and not substantial. So, getting kind of late and subtle here. This is deep working, deep and subtle. And so Ra used the word subtle a couple of times, because the mind has to be very delicate and nimble and sensitive to what's occurring, to do the work. So increasing sensitivity. Anyway, you see, that's why Ra talked about silence of self or silence of mind at a steady state. We can't observe, if we're driving in a car, it's very hard to get the bearings of another car that's driving past us. But if we're not moving, it's much easier to identify the target. It's much, you got to be settled to scope your target. And the target in this case is the content or the process of mind, which is particularly, whatever is uncomfortable or or difficult or uncomfortable, unpleasant for us. To see it clearly, it really helps to be quiet, and then you realize that, oh, okay, this stuff comes up and goes away. And it's why they say take a breath, take a deep breath, take a time out, take a moment. And then you'll see that it comes and goes. And you'll see that you, as an observer, are not that. That's the next stage. And that's discovering the completeness of mind or the polarities of mind. And then we accept them, which is also including that we can manifest many things that we don't like, which we would normally judge ourselves for, but judgment makes it worse. Okay, I can be a rager. I can be selfish. I can be, self-pitying. I can be cowardly. I can be deceptive. I can be, less than forthright or sincere in explaining something if I don't want to say it all. Whatever. Whatever is, I can be. But that doesn't mean I'm bad, because who are you really? And that's where we get to that kind of practice. Eckhart Tolle talking about who are you observing is coming from actually a teacher called Ramana Maharshi, who is also quite fully enlightened, as far as I can tell, and that's rare. And his practice was encouraging the disciples or the students to inquire, who are you? What am I? And that's one very traditional yoga or Hindu practice to discover the observer. And then there's some detachment from the patterns that are normally reflexive in mind, but that's not the last step. Thank you. Thank you all. I appreciate it too. Okay, good night.